the test of time, where the wind and waters rise, and plans are always breaking.
Joel was prophesying of this and proclaiming this. This prophetic outpouring was a foretelling of a greater harvest of salvation. In other words, it was going to say there's a few believers that were coming together. And now it's always easier to look back. What do they say? Hindsight is 20/20. We can look back and see the disciples of Jesus as they were getting ready and they were just few in number. Amen. But listen to what Joel prophesied. Let me say this before I get into this. In Joel 2:28, he says, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions." And then down to verse 32, he says, "And it shall come to pass that whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, among the remnant of whom the Lord calls." And so when the New Testament came along, we see the commands of Jesus going forth, and we see how Jesus told these few disciples there in Luke chapter 24, verse 49, he says, "And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power." So again, remember the Feast of Pentecost in the book of Deuteronomy, the priest would take the loaves of the grain and begin to just offer it before the Lord as a first fruits offering to say, this is the beginning. This is just the start of the harvest. There's a great harvest that's coming. It's like if we were planting, you know how it is when you're planting a garden, that you start watching and watching and watching, and finally that first little sprout comes out and you get excited and you just watch it and water it every day, and suddenly you see a little bloom pop up, and then you start to produce things. And when you take that first grain or produce off of the vine or off of the bush, it just is so exciting, and you start, the tomatoes are finally ready, the cucumbers are finally beginning to produce, and then you start to produce so much, you're like, well, you can't give it all away. You're trying to pass it off. I froze everything. I've canned everything I know how to can. I've done everything I know to do. I've eaten all I can. What am I going to do? Amen. And so that's what we see the priest doing. They were saying, this is the first fruits. This was what is being produced. But I know that this summer is just getting started. There's a great harvest that's coming. So I'm offering to you what has just begun. So now you picture the disciples as followers of Jesus. They stuck with him. They remained with him through all that was going on. And now he was crucified. And then he appeared to them. And we've celebrated Easter and the resurrection of the Lord and all that excitement. And so they're walking with him. They're experiencing some time with him. He's there, and 40 days after he rose from the dead, he is standing there and says, I've got to go back to my Father, but it's good for you that I go away, because if I go, I'll send you another comforter. And so wait for that promise. And so that's what we pick up at Luke 24, verse 49, when he begins to say, go to Jerusalem and tarry. Amen. And what is offered is there is they were offering their lives as these first fruit believers of the ones that were just the very foundation of the church. And we see the scriptures being fulfilled as they were just there in that upper room in prayer and studying the word and growing in their relationship with the Lord. And suddenly there came a sound that came to them. Amen. What I'm trying to say is God blessed that first fruits offering to say, you are just a foreshadowing of the harvest that is coming. Now you are to go into all the world and proclaim the gospel, and you're going to preach the gospel in every part of the world, and souls are going to believe, and then you're going to make disciples of them and baptize them in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Ghost, and you're going to bring them into a following and a gathering, and this gospel of the kingdom shall spread into all the world, it said. And what we see happening right before our eyes, the thing about it, we were born into this thing as it was already centuries old. So there has already been a great harvest. There's already been a mighty harvest and a great outpouring that's coming forth. And it's grown more in our lifetime, and we're seeing it more and more. And we're seeing all of that, but we're also seeing what Scripture says. But also in the last days, there'll be a great falling away. There'll be those that'll turn from the faith, but the harvest is still going to remain. And then we see all of these different times where Jesus was teaching and preaching about tares that were going to come up in the middle of the wheat, and you wouldn't know the wheat from the tares. He said, just let them remain together, and I will bring my angels will bring the they'll come along and they'll bring the division. They'll separate the wheat from the tares. Amen. And so all I'm trying to tell you is there's even a greater harvest than those disciples could have ever imagined. They just said, Lord, we're just going to offer ourselves to you. What I'm trying to tell you today, and I'm so far off my notes, I don't even know where I'm at right now, but I'm just trying to tell you that if you'll offer yourself to God and you'll say, Lord, take me just as I am, you have no idea of the harvest and the impact time that your life can make for the kingdom of God. You can win an entire family to the Lord. You can win your entire workplace to the Lord. You can be used mightily as a pillar of faith in this church and in the house of God. Who knows what God wants to do with you? Just offer yourself, as we were just singing that a moment ago. Lord, I give myself to you. Lord, I proclaim, I give you myself, I give you my song, I give you everything that's right, everything that's wrong, all my days, all my nights, all my hardships, all my disappointments, all my victories, all that I've had. God, I give it to you. Take me and use me for whatever you want for the kingdom of God, because this world needs somebody that's sold out for Jesus. This world needs somebody that's empowered by the Holy Ghost. This world needs somebody like you to rise up and say, I can't go on like this anymore. I need him. I need him. I need him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! My, my, my. Thank God. I give you myself, Lord. Give all that I am to you. I give it all to you. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there came an outpouring, and it so impacted the world. Amen. Because that occurred somewhere around. I mean, historians have debated and tried to guess whether it's AD 30 or AD 33 or we don't know. We just know there's a period of time, a segment of time within those 3 or 4 years that the outpouring of the Spirit came. Jesus had died. He was raised from the dead 7 weeks earlier. And now they've watched him ascend, and now they're waiting for the promise, and then it comes. The 10th day of their waiting was the day of Pentecost. And it's 50 days after the resurrection, and they heard that sound of rushing wind coming down from heaven, and it filled the house where they were sitting, the scripture says, and they saw tongues of fire that set on each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and finally they all began to speak with other tongues and languages as the Holy Spirit spoke through them. The manifestation of the outpouring of the Spirit of God was so powerful that it spilled out on everybody that was around them. That room couldn't hold them. They come out of that room, and the scripture says people out in the streets were hearing people proclaiming the praises unto Jesus in their own languages, in their own tongue, and said, "Who are aren't these folks? Who are they to speak in my language?" Amen. Somebody may try to tell you, "Who are you to try to tell us?" Amen. But don't listen to them. You are just simply somebody empowered by the Spirit of God. Amen. And somebody that's empowered by the Spirit of God, there's no limits on what God can do through them. Amen. Pentecost is retrospective, but it's also introspective, because there's an experience that happens on the inside of you. When you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it wasn't just limited to the upper room disciples, and so that I get sick of that teaching, that was just for them, and that was just when they died out, that power was gone. We just have to, you know, I've never seen anything like that in Scripture, because I see examples in Acts 10 when the outpouring of the Spirit came on the house of Cornelius, and it filled all them, and they began to speak with tongues. Acts 19, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit fell on a group of Ephesian believers, and they all began to speak in tongues, and as the Spirit came on them. Then Paul, later in his teaching, begins to lay out a pattern for the use of the gifts of tongues and other spiritual gifts in the church. And he begins to lay it out of how it should be decency and order and all of that. And he begins, why would he be teaching the early church if he says, y'all don't have to worry about it? If it was really, y'all don't have to worry about this, because once we die out, this is gone. He would have had reason to do, but he didn't do it. He says, we're going to be gone, and you guys need to operate in decency and order, and not let there be just confusion. You need some guidelines and some principles to go by, so that you can be empowered by the Spirit of the Lord. And he just began that, continued that teaching, and they were praying and in the Spirit, and the gifts of tongues was being offered, and the interpretation of tongues in a public setting. He says if a gift of tongues is given, there needs to be an interpretation. But he also talks about praying in the Spirit, or praying in tongues. Paul described it as, I pray in the Spirit, but I also pray in understanding. I pray, he says, I speak in tongues more than you all, he said. And so there's all of these examples that of Paul's teaching, that it's important that you and I walk in the power of the Spirit of God, and that we operate in the fruit of the Spirit, and let the gifts of the Spirit operate through us. He wants to fill us to an overflowing. There's so many testimonies, and you know, I didn't do good in my secular college education, because I remember when I'd have a break between classes, I'd go to the library to study my algebra. No, to study my none of that, none of my general ed. I found this book on the history of Christian denominations, and I began to read about all of these. I'd just go every day to that library. I'd steal away in that corner and read about how these Pentecostal organizations began to start up, or how these mainline denominations started up with a reviving, moving of the Spirit of God, and how the Spirit of God was poured out of. And I was just reading all of these, and I was so hungry and so thirsting for God that I just was so hungry that I'm thankful passed the classes I took in college, but it made me think, God, this, I need more than that. I want to grow in your word. I want to know you. And so I was already pursuing ministry. I already knew which direction I was heading. And so that's just where my mind stayed. And I, what I'm saying is, there's testimony and records all throughout history of people who just got tired of the status quo, and tired of church as usual, and tired of what was going on around them. And this is what serving God is like, then I don't want it, but I believe there's something else. And so they would read in the Word, and they'd begin to pray and say, this is what your Word says, this is what I've seen people do, and so if this is your Word, I want your Word. And they began to seek it, and God was pouring out His Spirit and power, and movements began to start. But again, when we just start looking back and just call out those times in history to say, remember when that happened, remember Azusa Street, remember when that happened in Topeka, Kansas, remember the great Welsh revivals. Just a few weeks ago, we had a missionary from Wales that came, if you remember, just a few weeks ago, and he's talked to Crystal and me at different times, and he says what was so powerful in Wales in the late 1800s and early 1900s that birthed the church. Now those church buildings are not thriving churches. They barely have 8 or 9 members to them, if that many. They are just walking around, or they're making they're staying afloat financially, because they become a museum, a memorial to what has been and what once was, and what it used to look like. And I want to tell you, we don't need to just be a memorial of what once was. We don't need to be a memorial of what our grandparents and our great-grandparents suffered for and sought God for. We need to be an ongoing, reviving, moving power of God to say, the church was empowered by the Spirit. The church is flowing now and operating now by the Spirit. Amen. We need to continue to flow in the Spirit of God.